Hey guys, welcome back to another interesting episode of Breaking the Ceiling, where we talk about the entrepreneurs behind the brands. Today is a very exciting episode for me because I'm interviewing my very, very old friend, my breakfast buddy from Bangalore. Oh, that's a mouthful, right? My breakfast buddy from Bangalore, Ashish Nichani from Postcard. Hey Ashish, welcome to Breaking the Ceiling.
Hey, hi Ashwin. Glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
So, we haven't had our... breakfast Bangalore Mondays for, I think, maybe a couple of years because of the pandemic. So next time I'm there, I'm going to be looking you up. So while we know about your past, I would love for our audience and our listeners to know a little bit about you. Can you tell me a little bit about yourself till before Postcard?
Sure. So, you know, I'm from Bangalore and, you know, born here, brought up here, done my schooling and all that here, did my engineering in Bangalore and then did my MBA from Delhi. Thereafter, I worked in Bombay at Axis Bank, you know, as part of their corporate office for 5 years. So worked across banking functions and, you know, thereafter came back to Bangalore, worked for a year and a half, 2 years in Bangalore as well in the banking. So typically, you know, sort of the typical sort of trajectory of sort of doing engineering and then an MBA and then getting into a bank. That was sort of my journey till 2014. 2014, me along with my co-founder Sudarshan, both of us were working at ING Vysya Bank in Bangalore before it was taken over by Kotak. And both of us were sort of, you know, we were at work, we were colleagues at work, but we bonded really, you know, over travel and food. These are two of our, you know, sort of defining passions in our life per se. And, you know, we were traveling together and always we noticed that, you know, most people travel to places and they've got a very different agenda. But for both of us, we would travel to places and we would essentially be thinking about where we're going to eat which meal. And it happened to us many times when we were traveling together. And that's when we realized that, you know, there's this thing about us that we really appreciate local food in different places. And our journey started off in 2014, where we decided that, okay, we were sort of tired of doing the banking job in a way, you know, sort of leading that structured life. And we felt that it was time for us to do something interesting and to sort of jump out of the normal. And in 2014, we decided that we're going to, you know, take that leap of faith. And we started off what was our first startup back then in 2014. We launched Place of Origin, which was India's first of its kind marketplace for specialty food. The concept stemmed from that love of food and travel. You know, and you, when you reflect on it at that point, when we were thinking about it, it was so natural. You know, you think of wherever you travel to, you're always bringing back what is that local specialty. Whenever somebody comes in office, somebody comes from somewhere, you always tell them, if you're going to Kerala, please bring me banana chips. If you're going to, you know, some other part of the country, please bring this particular thing. If you're going to the east, to Calcutta, please bring Sandesh back for me. It was very natural for us to be doing this. But in an era and in an age when you've got e-commerce developed for, you know, sort of food, for books and for electronics, why couldn't we do this with food? Because a lot of food actually can travel. So that's where we started off our journey in 2014. We started off with a marketplace called Place of Origin, built it to be India's first of its kind, the largest of its kind. We had around, we built an assortment, which was, you know, we reached out to 400 local food brands across the country in 125 locations and got 4,000 of their unique products onto this website. So it was sort of a mini, you know, sort of, when you say Amazon, it's aspirational, of course, but it's sort of to give you a sense of from that local food perspective, it had a lot of India's really, you know, sort of regionally famous food that we were able to bring on. So that's what we did from 2014 to 2019. We built that business up and learning from whatever we built at Place of Origin, learning from what our customers were telling us about what they liked, what was working for them, learning from what our vendors were telling us about what they found as useful in this platform and, you know, what they saw as an opportunity, putting all that stuff together and what we had built as our insight, that's where we came to Postcard and launched Postcard itself in 2019.
I love the name Postcard. Tell me about that.
You know, it's Place of Origin was very literal, right? I mean, there's very little to explain in that. It just tells you this is from there. And when we were sort of moving from that model of a marketplace to a brand, which is Postcard, which Postcard was, one of the things that we wanted was that we wanted a word, a name, which people could easily pronounce without, you know, having language barriers or understanding barriers. So Postcard was a simple one word to try and replicate that feeling. Now, what's the feeling we're talking about? The feeling is this, that if I'm opening a packet of this company, I want to feel that place. I want to be able to experience Calcutta in a packet. I want it to feel like a day trip to a place, saying that, you know, I took this flight, I landed in Chennai, I got that whiff of that local place in that packet that I was opening up there. So Postcard essentially is, you know, it's everything best about that place, which you capture in one frame, is what a postcard is. For us, it's the best food of that place captured in one packet, which is what a postcard packet is about.
I think when I heard that name, I was so intrigued, and I checked out your website, and it's, you know, fantastic. It's so user friendly, and the variety was, I think, for a lack of a better word, lip smacking. So because you know I'm a foodie, and I used to actually come to Bangalore only for the food, you know that, right? So the breakfasts and the lunch at Nagarjuna's, Corner House and other places. So I can totally relate with the origin behind the whole thing. While you were building Postcard, what are some of the challenges that you faced?
I think the biggest challenge in the space that we're in is the mindset of the folks that we're dealing with. Now, you know, when you're dealing with local food producers across the country, not all of them, and, you know, mind you, this is, we're talking of, you know, at least 4 or 5 years before, right? I mean, it's a different time zone from what it is post-pandemic. And back then, the challenge was that, why should I engage in this model? I have a shop, I'm locally famous in my small town here. Why should I do this? Why should I do that? Now, different parts of the country, people have different aspirations. There are certain parts of the country where folks are naturally attuned to wanting to grow their business and sort of are aggressive about growth for their own families and their own heritage, in a sense. But there are certain parts where folks are sort of more comfortable and content with what is there in their sort of ecosystem and, you know, their sort of life. For us, one of the biggest challenges has been trying to convince people of the opportunity there is and the need for actually, you know, getting beyond your base market. Because how else do these brands grow? If you think about it, how else, you know, if you're famous in one town, how do you grow bigger than that? And there are enough examples of people who've actually done it and succeeded, but it still is a challenge for a lot of people from a mindset perspective to think that, you know, maybe we need to experiment, innovate, and do something different. So I think that is one challenge that we've, you know, sort of worked on through the years. And I think off late in you know, sort of post the entire COVID sort of situation, the need for being in alternate channels where you can, you know, sort of de-risk your business from sort of whatever disturbances you might have has hit home. And therefore, it's a lot easier for people to sort of, accept that there are alternate models of business that they can be a part of. So I think that is one of those things. The second thing that we've also felt is that when you evolve in a business model, when you want to grow as well, the necessity for you to sort of comply and to be aligned with whatever other regulations is something very important in the food business. And that continues to be sort of a bit of a challenge that we see across the board, that, you know, people are running all those businesses, flourishing and all of that, but it's not the easiest for everybody to comply because India does have a lot of regulation that's there. It takes a lot of folks to be actually compliant on everything because things change as well, and you need that information to keep pace with that change. So I think that is also something that we've faced through the time to get everybody to comply with and therefore grow together.
While you were building your team, what were some challenges that you faced? What were some insights that you got?
You know, when you're building a startup team, it's very different from like how we used to work in the bank, right? When you're working in a large organization with 2,000 people in it, you can have people of varying levels of motivation and you can get away with it. The bank will continue to run. Nothing's going to change in that whole thing. But when you're running a startup where it's, let's say, 10 people, 15 people, or, you know, maximum 20 people, one of the things you cannot compromise on is the passion with which people are there. Because in a startup, it's not an 8-hour job which is highly structured and you can just live within that sort of, you know, within those guardrails and everything is perfect. It's not. It's a lot of, a lot of things that you're juggling through. It's a lot of situations where you need to define processes on the go. It's a lot of situations where you realize that anybody who has to succeed in that environment has to be thinking or taking two steps ahead of what their typical role definition allows them to, you know. So that is something. So I think the first and the biggest insight that we faced is that if we realize that folks are passionate about the space and the objective of the company, everything else falls together, falls in place. The challenges start when people approach it like another job. And honestly, I haven't seen any successful startup across industry, across categories or anywhere where, you know, they've succeeded on the back of folks who've not been as motivated and driven, you know, sort of as you'd want them to be. Now, when you're thinking about it as founders, founders by definition and by default have to be that motivated, right? Otherwise, why would you put yourself through running a startup in India? And why would you try and, you know, sort of do what you do? But it's, you know, sort of the insight or the effort that we need to take as founders is to be able to translate that passion and that vision to everybody. And what I've also learned is that the more, you know, personally, at least I can say this, is that the more we've communicated on that vision, the more we've put that thought process out and be transparent about that, we've seen folks come forth, you know, and take those additional steps and sort of taken ownership more than the average. And that's really worked for us. There are points of time when, you know, you get distracted as a founder and so on, or you have some other things happening and you don't communicate as much. And those are the difficult phases. So it's easier to say perhaps because, you know, I'm reflecting in hindsight perhaps, but I think that is sort of the necessity is to have people with passion at the growth stage that, you know, that sort of we were in, let's say. Sort of the necessity is for the founders to take charge of instilling that kind of passion in people, because otherwise, without an idea of why we're doing what we're doing, it's very difficult for everybody else to feel as excited about it, you know, as we would. Yeah.
I remember when I started Equinox, almost now 17 years ago, and started as a startup, you know, working very hard, got good teammates. But where I failed was to communicate my vision of what we wanted to achieve in the world. Like, I knew it. I just didn't articulate it enough, or I didn't reiterate it enough with the team. So that's been one of my biggest learnings. Any new thing I start now, the first thing we start with, why do we exist? What are our core values? And, you know, what is our vision? What is our mission? So now we will not even start any new venture without having this clarity, and this clarity being communicated to all teammates, right? Because once that clarity is there, automatically your vibe will, you know, attract your tribe. So now when we attract people, they understand what is it that we're trying to do and they're passionate about it. And if we don't see that same passion, the guy on paper may be fantastic, but if you don't get that same feeling, ki, hey, this guy is going to be putting in his heart, you know, blood, sweat, and tears to achieve the same goal that we have, we don't take them on board, right? So the culture fit is almost, I think, the most paramount thing we look at. We don't even look at basic skills. Skills can be taught, but that passion, that culture fit is absolutely critical. That's something that, you know, I made a mistake 17 years ago. I don't repeat that anymore.
I was just saying that, you know, in our case, it's also, in a lot of cases, you know, we find that food is such an easy way to break that barrier of communication, because we have folks who join us from all over the country. Like, we had folks from Guwahati coming in, and we had folks from Kerala and so on. And then you get them to try foods from different parts. It's an experience and an education in itself. And that's a motivation factor in itself, saying that, you know, I've discovered something new, which is so exciting. What can I do to get this across to other people and make them interested? So for us, it's a very, it's a sensory sort of experience that starts on day one itself.
So I think that leads me to the next part, which is, what motivates you? I kind of think I know the answer, but I would love to hear from you. What motivates you?
For us, when we are so passionate about food and we really love food, I think the biggest motivation for us has been to see that happiness when we make somebody have something, we delight them in that food that they have. That happiness that we see, you know, is sort of, it's the best motivation. And we do a lot of these events, and we've, you know, we go and stand in stalls and sort of, you know, have all these sampling events and all of that happening. And that's where, you know, because that's motivation for us. It drives us. It refuels us in a way. Because you just need to see somebody open a packet, eat something that they're not used to. Okay, it's not about saying that, oh, you know, my mom made this and you made something similar. We're not in that business. We're about making you discover something that you have not tasted. That's what we're about. And when they open that and they taste it and they said, you know, this is so amazing and I've never had this. Why have I not had this? I'm living in the same country. People can pronounce Italian food better than they can pronounce food in, you know, sort of our local food. But that is one big motivation. In the food space, you know, when you see people get happy about what they're having, that I think is the number one motivation for us. Beyond that, of course, there are other things that, you know, all of us as founders feel happy about. You see your brand grow, you see people, you know, talk about you in the third person, or you see, you know, sort of your brand being mentioned in different circles. I had somebody calling me from Coca-Cola, you know, sort of their office, telling me that, you know, there was a conversation and this came out there and that happened. One of our favorite stories is we were on a flight, you know, sort of flying to Europe, to France, I remember. And the folks sitting alongside us, which was, you know, really random, just having a conversation with people on a flight, and they sort of tell you about your brand. And then you suddenly feel this really, you know, this moment of pride. So I think a lot of those moments of pride do exist, and they come in many shapes, sizes, and forms. But ultimately, it's, you know, it's just that customer happiness when somebody emails us and tells us that, you know, we made their day, their mom was really happy with something that they tried, you know, or they tasted something and they were happy. It's just customer happiness that, you know, keeps you going. Otherwise, in the food business, what else is there? You don't need to make yourself happy, you make others happy, right?
I think that's amazing. So for any business to be successful, they need to be very, very good at marketing, because you may have a fantastic product, but if nobody knows about your product, you're not going to grow as a company. What has been your marketing hack, or marketing secret, or marketing strategy?
I don't say that we've been like the best at it, or we've really cracked a certain code at it, because, you know, sort of we've done, you know, the best we could with whatever we had, and, you know, that's sort of been our journey. But I think what's worked for us is the more we've kept it natural, the more we've, you know, sort of we've taken customers on a journey, and that's really helped us. You know, the point is that the more content we've been able to provide customers with, the more information we've provided them, you know, that's where we felt we've got the best returns on our marketing sort of strategy. So the good thing about India and what we do is that between history, facts, entertainment, you know, humor, all of these come together, and, you know, sort of food can engage with all of these aspects, and the customer feels engaged, and that's what's helped on marketing sites. So, you know, I think that's one big thing. And beyond that, in the food space, it's just, you know, if you have referrals happening for you, if you have people talking about you, that sort of propels it on its own. So it's a combination between content that we put out and contented customers and what they put out, if I put it that way.
So what I have seen, and when I came across Postcard and not hearing it from you, was other people telling me, oh, I tried this little, you know, thing, and hey, like when you come home, I have this, you know, thing I want you to try. They didn't mention the brand, but when I went home, it was your product over there, right? Which is, I was like, wow, like, that is fantastic to see, you know, that people are excited about food. And I think food is such a natural thing for people to share, right? So, like, I know if I bring, like, a bibimbap from Goa, like, when I have guests over, I'm going to take it out, I won't share it to people, I won't tell people, like, have you tried this? So, I think that natural instinct of people to share food and good food, I think is going to be a literally your strongest marketing tactic, is going to be just deliver amazing, you know, amazing product, amazing.
That's why I love Diwali, right? That's why I just love Diwali, because that's the one occasion where we all want to gift food items. And if it's good food, then you gift it. And what happens is you have a customer and the person who bought it. You have a customer who's going to come to you and the person who's been gifted, like you said, right? And it just works in a sort of symbiotic way. And, you know, gifting is actually a hack of its own, if you really think about it that way.
So as an entrepreneur, family life can be quite tough managing, and especially a startup entrepreneur. Have you faced any challenges with work-life balance, and how has you being an entrepreneur affected your personal life?
I think, frankly, as much as we think about work-life balance and all of that, when you're in the early stages and in those growth stages of a company, you know, as a startup or as a founder, there's a very thin line, and it just doesn't exist in my view. The only reality is that your family has to understand what you're going through. You have to co-opt them on the journey to some extent so that they understand, you know, why you have a certain mood on a certain day, or why, you know, you need to get up and you need to come back at this time or go at that time or whatever it is, right? So I think that's been, I think that was straight off the bat, that was a realization saying that, you know, it's not possible to say that, okay, 7 o'clock, 7:30, I shut and I go. It doesn't happen. It just doesn't happen, because your mind is there. The phone, of course, is omnipresent. That's not going anywhere. So business and work travels along with you. But it's just to accept that and to say that, yes, this is what this phase is about. You know, sort of because we're two co-founders, it's a lot better for us because, you know, each person can sort of take a differential load at different points of time depending on what's required. So that has really helped us and worked for us. I think the only other thing that I've seen, I'm not the most fit person at all, and Ashwin knows that because he's met me in person. So, you know, no hiding that. Anybody who sees this will know that if they know me. But I think what's helped is, it definitely has helped on the times, you know, whenever I've kept to a routine of doing something, sort of, you know, some sort of a workout or an exercise thing for myself, that has really helped. Sure, reading and stuff like that also helps at different points of time, you know, but it's a little challenging to get that stretch of time other than having a flight to Delhi, I suppose, for me. But a little bit of a workout routine and, you know, to that extent is what we do. I think one other thing that we've kept true to is taking a sort of a dedicated break for a few days. That travel always helps to, it doesn't restore a balance per se, but it just helps keep things go, right? With your folks and with everybody around saying that, yes, you know, we have like a post-Diwali break, you know, or a year-end break kind of thing that you do. So some of the small things, I mean, you have to give up on the ideal saying that I'm going to have this perfect ideal balance, but can I sprinkle life with a little bit of, you know, some sort of a like a weekend break or a sort of a workout here, whatever you catch in between, and, you know, you sail along.
I think the whole health piece, right, it took me a long, long time, like 15 years to figure out that health is actually more important than business. And somewhere actually correlated the two. I'm like, one second, I'm not going to be healthy, I can't work. So maybe that made me, going to push me to get more into workouts, more into nutrition, more into some things. And I think the pandemic helped too, right? So through the pandemic, I did focus a lot more on health, and, you know, I've kind of lost a little weight, gotten a little fitter, and hopefully going to get more fitter as the time goes by. And the mini vacations, just that 1-2 days, right? But that helps you recharge your batteries. Because see, if you keep draining, that, and you need to, and if you need to give, you need to have something to give, right? As they say, you can't pour from an empty cup. So you need to figure out what kind of helps you refill your own cup. Like for me, it is, I go for a morning jog. Like it's non-negotiable, like 1 hour every morning, I'm out for a jog. That helps me think, it helps me, I use that time to listen to audiobooks, I use that time to think. Because many times through the day, you know, we sometimes don't control our day, other people control our day. Right, so that alone time actually becomes a very good thinking time to, you know, strategize and, you know, things. But having that, I think, is critical. Tell me, how do you handle, you know, different kinds of failures, demotivation? I'm very sure a lot of things have broken at some point or time. How have you handled?
I think if you ask my co-founder, he'll sort of tell you that, yeah, you know, that's the moment when I'll come wailing or I'll come, you know, ranting about something that's happened. So I think venting it out is step one. You know, having someone to talk it out to is, I think, a critical thing. And, you know, we take it for granted when we have it. But when you don't have it, you really know the value of it. So that is the first thing, to be able to have someone that you can talk out stuff that's on your mind. You know, that's one thing. I think the other thing is that, you know, again, because there are two of us, it really helps. Because when one person is demotivated, the other person takes it on itself to sort of, you know, to look at the positive side of things, right? Like, it's a cliche term, but it really does happen. But it requires somebody else to say it, because it's not going to come from within. When you're in a situation and you're feeling sort of down with it, you're not going to think of the positive side, frankly. It doesn't happen. But it requires somebody else to be able to say that. So the power of two really plays out for us in this case, that, you know, we're able to balance that out for each other. But situations do happen, you know, sort of, you have a conversation, you're expecting sort of a certain outcome to happen, and that really doesn't come through, you know, sort of, it's a natural outcome, it's going to happen. I don't think I claim to have a magic wand to be able to do it, but a lot of these things really help. I mean, you indulge a certain passion on that day, you distract yourself with something that you're happy about. You know, my favorite example is that, you know, on a really bad day, everybody knows that you just need to give this guy a piece of chocolate cake and it'll all work out. You know, that's sort of my go-to in a situation of that sort. But, you know, food really plays its own role again, you know, come back to food. But I think it's just about having someone that you can talk things through. Because in that own, when you reflect in that conversation, you know, you're able to solve most of the things in your own mind, or reconcile with them at least. You know, in that process,
I think that ability to overcome failures is absolutely critical, because as an entrepreneur, you're going to fail. 120% you're going to fail. There's never a chance that you're going to try something, it's going to work. You try 10 different things, all 10 are going to work. Like in my case, we try 10 different things, one or two will work. Others, eight will fail. Right? But those one or two is actually what helps us, you know, succeed. So I'm glad that you have a very, very nice mechanism and obviously chocolate cake to help you through those steps. So I would want to know, what is a habit or a ritual that you have that helps you become more productive, helps you become more energetic, or anything that helps you become successful?
I tend to write things down. I think that's a very simple thing, but it really, you know, sort of helps. I'm sort of the notebook sort, but notes also work. Chalega. But the point is to literally just, you know, sort of jot them down, because I think with the amount of things that are on our mind, it's very natural to be overloaded in that sense, and you forget. And that's something that you want to fight against, you know, if you really want to sort of do things better. So writing things down, keeping notes, keeping tabs on it is something that helps. That's one. One thing as a team that we do is sort of, we have a daily catch-up call, for example. That's something that's really helped at a team level, because, you know, what ends up happening in those calls is that everybody gets a sense of what everybody is doing. Everybody is able to plan their day in reflection, in a conversation. So everybody's aligned every day. So I think that that morning first hour of work is critical. It sort of sets the tone for your day. You want to make an effort to start it on a positive note. You want to make an effort to organize yourself in that 1 hour, because then you know at the end of the day that, you know, what have you done, what do you need to do, so on, and you know the next day where you're going to start off again. So it's a bit of you know, organization that I think is something that really helps us in a way. That's what I would say is critical.
I was in US 2 weeks ago, and I met with a CEO of $100 million, and it was a 15-20 minute interaction, and he was about to go on stage to give his keynote. And we were discussing something, and, you know, we've done work together for the last 7-8 years, and every year I meet him, and we discussed some points. He was on his phone and he was typing something out. So first I thought, oh, maybe he's sending out a message. So I kind of stopped talking. He's like, oh, why did you stop? I said, oh, you can finish your message. He's like, no, I'm jotting down what you're saying. I said, really? Like, because since we were in a conference, he didn't really have something to write on, or he didn't have a laptop or an iPad, right? So he was typing on the phone. Then he showed me the phone. He had two things that he had put. One was, he had put my name, a date, learning, bold, left some space, to-dos. And he was jotting down everything he was learning from me. And then below, there were some to-dos that he had his team to do. He had written down the to-dos. End of my meeting, he took the learnings, copied it, put it on a Slack channel with all his leadership, his entire leadership team. To-dos were sent to his EA to distribute to his team. That was fantastic. I was like, I was inspired. After a long time, I saw like a, you know, a CEO doing something this way, and I was blown away. I was like, and he didn't need to do any of it. He could have had somebody else take notes, right? But he himself did it, and I'm inspired. Now that's something I've started with. Every time I meet somebody, I've now started typing learning and to-dos. But what I've seen is, when you meet people like this, when you meet, and by the way, he's one of my mentors, right? When you meet people this way, you learn so many new things that you possibly couldn't have done, or you may take years to figure out this, right? So that brings me to my next question, which is, what roles do mentors play in your life? Do you have any mentors? And if you have mentors, what role do they play in your life?
So I think it's critical to have folks that you look up to, folks that you can sound off ideas with, folks who are sort of, who feel invested in your success for no reason. You know, so they don't need to have a reason for it also. It need not even be that they're an investor per se, but they just need to feel somewhere that, you know, your concept or your idea or you as a person, you know, sort of, they're interested in that piece. So we definitely have folks that we sort of look up to. So one of those is Revanth Pate of Man Matters Mosaic Wellness. He's somebody who's, you know, that whom we really look up to as an example of somebody who's putting together a really massive company and a super successful startup, and he's still so grounded in all the, you know, sort of the nitty-gritties of that work. And you know, sort of, I try to reach out to him at different points of time, but I recently met him a couple of weeks back as well. And you know, a lot of these things. So even the point that you mentioned about just taking down notes is something that I'd actually picked from him when we met him initially as well. So he's someone we look up to. The role that they play essentially is, you know, the way I look at them is that, yes, there is a day-to-day that we grapple with, and sometimes you need sort of an alternate insight from somebody who's maybe, you know, maybe other founders. We have very strong founder connections, and that's actually a really strong channel itself, because you go through the same process, you have similar problems, so it's great to interact with them. So that's one. So one part is discussing your regular day-to-day challenges that are there. But somewhere, mentors who are at a different plane, they have an additional role, because they can extract you from that situation and make you look at yourself and your situation from a higher plane. And that's when you reflect and say that, you know, does this make sense? You know, am I doing this? And yes, I have to go through the nitty-gritty. I have to, you know, solve my challenges. But what's the larger picture about? So I think mentors for us work at two planes. One is, you know, as founders, other founders of other startups, a lot of them that we interact with, folks who have built really good, you know, sort of solid businesses, folks who are struggling us through, you know, through the same challenges, they're equally good mentors to us. That's one. And then on the other hand of it, people who can make you think of the larger picture. These are two sort of, you know, people we interact with.
That is fantastic. So every time I have met somebody who is on the pinnacle of success in their field, or done things that I possibly couldn't have thought of doing in the, at least the time frame they did it in, I've always learned so much from them, and I always try to figure out, hey, how can this person, you know, help me? I have mentors who may spend 15 minutes in a year, or I have mentors who may spend 2 hours, you know, every 2 weeks, right? But having that ecosystem around you gives you access to so many years or decades of learning within minutes and hours, and you don't have to spend all that time, make all those mistakes. And as you correctly said, sometimes you just need somebody to inspire you, somebody to pull you out of one orbit and, you know, help you get into the next orbit, or letting you know that you can get into the next orbit much faster by doing this rather than the way you're thinking. Instead of taking the stairs, hey, there's an elevator right there. Right? Like somebody just points you in the right direction. Say, hey, why don't you take the elevator? Instead of walking up 63 flight of stairs, there's an elevator right there. Just press the button and you can go up, right? So those insights have been invaluable, right? So I know there is some big news that's coming up. Is there something you'd like to tell me of what's happening with Postcard and something that's going to be happening in the next few days, weeks or months?
Sure. Very happy to sort of share it, and sort of sharing it with you is equal happiness, because you've seen the journey that we've gone through since 2015, you know. So somewhere I look at you as somebody who's a passenger along this journey of, you know, what it's been for Sudarshan and me. We're happy to sort of share that, you know, Postcard is now part of Windreen's world. We've been acquired by the Windreen's world sort of collective. Windreen's world, for folks who don't know or may not know, because, you know, sort of sometimes people don't put it together, but Windreen's world is a collective of brands such as Windreen's Farms itself, Raw Presserie, Monsoon Harvest, Sorcery and others, where it's our collective ambition to sort of serve a new age Indian customer, which is sort of common to all of us somewhere, with foods and beverages which are honestly better for them. I think one thing that's conclusive about a post-pandemic world is that everybody is seeking something that they define as better for them. That's the aspiration that's very clearly there. And that has created a space for brands, you know, to sort of exist and to serve those customers. And somewhere what's happening, you know, what we're doing together as Windreen's world is essentially trying to use the synergies of everything that all these brands have built. We're, of course, a very, very tiny part of it, and, you know, very small part of it in that sense. And, you know, sort of Raw and Windreen's are much larger brands. And that's where it really works out, sort of the synergies work out for us, because we're able to leverage off, you know, infrastructure, knowledge, expertise, talent that's there across this entire ecosystem to take Postcard to its next orbit, in a sense, right? So that's something that's just happened, and it's something that's really something that we're very happy about, something that's giving us, you know, when you think about what motivates you, now this motivates us, because this is giving us an opportunity to literally sort of grow exponentially with, you know, without having commensurate sort of money being poured in or something like that. It's giving us that, you know, sort of the elevator in a sense. So we're really looking forward to this phase. It's a good time.
That is absolutely fantastic news. Congratulations to you, Sudarshan, and the entire Postcard team. That's a landmark event right there, right? That was absolutely fantastic, and I'm so happy. And I'm so happy because I know I've seen you guys start off, you know, literally like small little office, and now you guys are growing and you're becoming a part of Windreen's world. I think that's absolutely kick-ass. Right. My last question to you, what advice would you give a person who wants to become a food entrepreneur?
Oh, wow. I honestly have never put myself, you know, sort of thinking that I'd be able to sort of give advice in any form. But wow, I think somewhere, some of these things sound cliche, but what I've seen over time is that there are folks who start off with a certain concept, and then, you know, sort of you have market forces, you've got investor sentiment that's there, you've got, let's say, news reports, or you've got certain mentors who nudge you in a particular direction, and you tend to mold yourself to answer or to become an answer for everybody else's aspirations somewhere along the way, right? It happens. It happens because, yes, as a startup, you are going to look to raise funding from different people, and they will all have a certain opinion. The right or wrong of it is not even the point, but they will have an opinion for sure. But I think somewhere, when you try to do that or you end up doing that, you kind of lose out on what your original motivation was. And if that happens, it's very difficult to sustain yourself. Forget about your team, forget about investors or whatever else it is, right? It's very difficult to sustain yourself if you're going to sort of morph into something that you didn't set out to be. So somewhere I feel that, you know, you either stick to what you're thinking about or what motivates you or what your aspiration is, because your successes along the way will come along that path. If not, it's not going to be your story, it's not going to be your brand, it's not going to be your startup that you're believing in somewhere. So I think it's just that much saying that, you know, stay true to what your concept and all of that was. That's not to say that you don't pivot. It's not to say that you don't get motivated or you don't get inspired by what others are doing. You definitely want to do all of that, right? But it still has to be your story. It has to be something that you own, and because you have to sort of sleep with it, get up with it, live with it, run with it. So, you know, that's sort of my only two cents. And I really don't want to call it advice, but I just say call it, you know, something that I can reflect on with all the people that I've seen and conversations that I've had around me. So, yeah.
I think that's invaluable advice, because as you grow, and especially when you get investors and, you know, outside influences coming in, you will be given so many different directions. You'll be given so many different pushes. You should only do those if you truly believe that that's what is best for your organization, right? So just because an investor doesn't mean that they're right. Just because, you know, your best friend is also running his own startup and he gives you some advice doesn't mean he's right. Take all the inputs that you get, give it your own thought, and then applying, you know, your flavor of whatever that advice is to your company, I think is one of the best things you've said. So thank you so much for that insight, Ashish, and thank you so much for coming on the show. This is so, I'm feeling so nice meeting you. I mean, we're meeting after so, like, maybe 2-3 years we haven't met because of the pandemic, and I can't wait to again have breakfast and lunches in Bangalore the next time I'm there. Thank you so much for being here.
Soon, whenever you're next. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So guys, that was Ashish from Postcard. Go check out his website right now. Just before the show, I went and I bought a bunch of things and I'm waiting for my postcards to arrive. And it was a lip-smacking experience. Even if you don't buy anything, just go check it out. It's a first-class e-commerce experience that you can get. And the amount of things you will discover on his website are absolutely phenomenal. And I'm hoping you've taken something away from today's interaction. Ashish has been a serial entrepreneur. He's done a couple of things. So I hope you've learned something from this. And I'm hoping you can use that learning to break some ceilings in the future. I'll see you guys in the next one. Thanks.